Let's pray together and we'll jump in this morning. Jesus, we love you and thank you so much for loving us and thank you for dying on the cross to save us. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for your holy word. We thank you, God, that when we read it, we read your very word. And we pray today as we overview this book of Psalms that you'll speak to our hearts. Lord, I don't know of another book in Scripture that we can go to when we face the experiences of up and down in our lives, and the Psalms just speaks to our souls. So thank you for it. Thank you for those who had a part in writing it down as you gave it to them. And Lord, I pray today that you bless every person here. Thank you for each one who has made his or her way here. And God, you know we all have prayer needs. You know what they are. And we lift them to you and we ask you to work according to your perfect will in our lives that we might glorify you in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Okay, turn there to the book of Psalms. How many of you have read the book of Psalms all the way through? Look at all the hands. All the way through the book of Psalms. How many of you have read the Bible all the way through? Wow, that's something else. That's great. I would encourage you to try to do that. Billy Graham used to say that he read 5 chapters in Psalms every day and 1 chapter in the book of Proverbs every day. And he said he'd done that for years and years. I imagine he still does after all these years. The book of Psalms helps our relationship with God, he said. And the book of Proverbs helps our relationship with one another, he said. So it's good to read the book of Psalms and the book of Proverbs. In fact, no other book of the Bible compares with this sacred collection of Scripture, this portion of Scripture that we know as inspired worship songs. And that's what the Psalms are made up of. This is inspired worship songs. This is God's hymn book. When we open the Psalms, we open God's hymn book. And you think about the Psalms and how the book of Psalms has been a bedrock of comfort to you through the years, or how it's been a tower of strength. So many times in my own life, I've opened the Psalms and God just brought me great comfort in the book of Psalms. Have you ever had that to happen in your life? God just speaks to your heart in the Psalms. In fact, someone has said every range of human emotion that it is possible for us to experience is addressed in the book of Psalms. Every psychological experience that we can go through is mentioned in the book of Psalms. When we're high, when we're low, or when we're just steady along, the book of Psalms will speak to our hearts. This book was written some 3,000 years ago in the days of ancient Israel. And yet you read the Psalms and they're just as vibrant and just as fresh and just as relevant today as they were when they were first written. That's why the Word of God is called a living Word. It is quick and powerful. It is living. It's relevant today just like the day that it was written. More than any other portion of Scripture, the book of Psalms has influenced public worship and private devotions. And I would encourage you to try to read through the book of Psalms in your private devotions. If you read a chapter a day, just read a chapter as you have your devotions and talk to God about what you find in that chapter. It's a rich experience just to read through and pray through the book of Psalms. In order for the Psalms to be rightly understood, we need to understand a little bit of its historical background and understand some of the things in the book. So that's what we're going to do today in a journey through the Bible. This is an overview of the book of Psalms. So let's look at some of the unique features that we find here in the book of Psalms. It's a one-of-a-kind book. There's really no other book exactly like it in the Bible. It's very unique. One reason is that the book of Psalms is the largest book in the Bible. It is the largest book in the Bible. How many chapters does it have? 150. So it is the largest book in the whole Bible. If each psalm is considered a chapter, then Psalms also contains the most chapters of any book in the Bible. It's the largest Bible. It has the most chapters of any book in the Bible. Number two is the book of Isaiah. And Isaiah only has 66 chapters. Psalms has 150. So you can see the difference. It's by far the largest. It's by far the book with the most chapters. It also has the largest chapter in the Bible. The largest chapter. Do you know what chapter that is?
119.
Very good. 119, that's right. And Psalm 119 has 176 verses in it. It is the longest chapter in the Bible. In fact, it's longer than many of the short books in the Bible. And it also has the shortest chapter in the Bible in it. Not only the longest, but the shortest. Who knows what the shortest chapter is? It's close. How about 117? 117 is the shortest chapter in the Bible. In fact, if you want to read a chapter in the Bible today, read Psalm 117. It's only two verses, and you've read a chapter in the Bible. Psalm 117 is also the middle chapter in the Bible. It's the middle chapter. I'm just giving you Bible trivia about the book of Psalms. It's the middle chapter in the Bible. It's the very center of 1,189 chapters found from Genesis through the Revelation. It's the dead center of the Bible. Psalm 118, verse 8, is the absolute center of the Bible, of all the verses in the Bible. How many verses do you think that there might be in the Bible? You want to guess? Or maybe you know. I didn't know this till I looked it up. Anybody want to take a guess? Oh, come on. Somebody try. How many verses in the Bible? Okay. Well, there's a bunch, but not quite that many. How many of you think there would be 25,000 verses in the Bible? Raise your hand. Yeah, you're right. You're right. More than that. More than that. 31,173. 31,173 verses. Now think about this. If you've read the Bible through, that's how many verses you've read. 31,173. And the middle verse in the entire Bible of all those verses is Psalm 118, verse 8. So, you remember when we had sword drill when we were kids?
Yeah.
And they teach you, when they called out the book of Psalms, you didn't even have to look, did you? What did you do? Just open the middle of the Bible, and there you were. That's because the book of Psalms is in the middle of the Bible. Psalms is written by more authors than any other book in the Bible. Now, we know God is the author, but I'm talking about the scribes, the people that God used to write the book. More authors than any other book in the Bible. It was written by different people. And we'll look at that in a little while. It took almost 1,000 years to write the book of Psalms because it was written by so many people. So many different people over a period of time. It was 900 to 1,000 years to write the book of Psalms. Did you know Psalms is quoted more often? It's the most quoted Old Testament book in the New Testament. When you see Old Testament quotes in the New Testament, there is more from the book of Psalms than any other book. Psalms contains more prophecies of the Messiah than any other Old Testament book, with the possible exception of the book of Isaiah. For example, in Psalm 2, it talks about the Messiah as the Son of God. In Psalms 8, it talks about Jesus as the Son of Man. In Psalm 40, it talks about the obedience of the Messiah. In Psalm chapter 41, it talks about his betrayal. In Psalm 20, read Psalm 22 sometime. We need to do a verse-by-verse study of 22. That's the crucifixion. The Psalms talks about the crucifixion of the Messiah before crucifixion was even a method of execution. They didn't even know what crucifixion was. Hadn't been invented yet. But the psalmist talked about how the Messiah would be crucified. And here's the beautiful thing to me about Psalm 22. When you read the gospel accounts, we're looking up at the cross. We see what Jesus went through on the cross. But when we read Psalm 22, we read what it was like for Jesus looking down from the cross. We see the mind of Jesus and the thoughts of Jesus as he was hanging on the cross and he looked down at the people and he looked through the eons of time. So that's a very beautiful psalm. Now let's think about a minute about the book title, the title of the book. The word Psalms means plucking strings. Plucking strings. It comes really from a Greek word which means the plucking of strings. It literally means a song that is to be sung to the accompaniment of an instrument, where they pluck the strings, such as a harp. So the Psalms is a collection of worship songs to be sung to God by the people of Israel with musical accompaniment. Have you ever tried to sing the Psalms? You know, God even enjoys that when I do it. If I can do it, you sure can do it. Because God knows I can't sing. But when I sing the Psalms to him, he's not listening to me. He's listening to his word. And that gives him joy. So just sing one of the Psalms to him today. Pick one out. If you're intimidated, pick that shortest chapter out and sing those two verses to him. It's a book of praise. It's a book that God made to use to praise him. In fact, the ancient Hebrews called it the Book of Praises. The Book of Praises. Now let's look for a little bit about the human authors, the people who actually God inspired to write the Book of Psalms. It had multiple authors. Most of the books of the Bible were written by one person under the inspiration of God's Holy Spirit, but several were written by more than one, and Psalms is an example. So I want you to see, first David wrote 75 of the Psalms. He was the king of Israel. Remember, David was called what? The sweet psalmist of Israel. Now a lot of these Psalms, David probably wrote in his heart when he was a shepherd boy, and he was out there tending to the sheep, and he was out there by himself, and he played the harp, and he got very good at playing the harp because King Saul wanted him to come and play for him to soothe his mental illness. So David could play the harp, and he would play and sing these songs. And can you just imagine him out there among the sheep, nobody else around, and David in his heart singing these songs to God? And that's where many of these songs came from. They were hymns of David's heart to God. 75 of them. He is the chief author of the Psalms. Then there's a man named Asaph. And Asaph wrote 12 of them. Asaph was a priest who served as the worship leader of ancient Israel. So Asaph was the minister of music, and he wrote 12 of these psalms in ancient Israel. Then there was the sons of Korah. The sons of Korah was a guild of singers, so to speak. They composed music, and they wrote 10 of the psalms God inspired them to do. Solomon, David's son, wrote 2 psalms. Moses wrote 1 psalm. Do you know which one? Psalm 90. Psalm 90 was written by Moses. If you've ever heard Brother Fred Thompson at a funeral, I love Fred. And Fred's memorized that 90th psalm. And he uses that almost at every funeral he does. And he'll quote that by heart. And I just love to hear him do that. And that 90th psalm was written by Moses. Then there was a man by the name of Haman. Haman was considered to be a wise man, a musician. He was the son of Korah. He wrote 1 psalm. He wrote 1 psalm. That was Haman. Did I leave that out, Jerry?
Is it, okay. It's on the other side.
On the other. I got you. I just couldn't see it. I see it back there now. Okay. And then Ethan. Ethan was another wise man. He was a Levitical singer. He wrote 1. He wrote Psalm 89. 48 of the psalms were written by anonymous writers. And it is believed that Ezra, who was a scribe and priest of Israel, may have been the author of some of those anonymous psalms. Now, when you think about all of the people who had a part in writing the psalms as God spoke to their heart, then you understand the time period for the writing of the psalms and why this time period took such a long time, spanning a period of 900 to 1,000 years. The time of the writing of the Psalms goes from about 1410 B.C. to 430 B.C., possibly 430. It really depends on who you think wrote Psalm 126, but we're not going to go into that this morning. The very first psalm that was ever written, which one do you think?
90.
That's exactly right. That's a pretty safe thing in it here. If Moses wrote it, it was the first one. Yep. Psalm 90 was the first one ever written. He wrote that during Israel's 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. The vast majority of the psalms were written during the reigns of David and Solomon, which would have been around 1,000 B.C. The last psalm to be written was Psalm 126. And that was written after Israel's Babylonian exile. Now let's look at the purpose of the psalms. No matter where we are in our Christian life, no matter what we're going through in our life, the Psalms are written to guide us in the worship of God. And so, as I mentioned earlier, they're to be sung. They're to be sung devotionally. And this was God's hymn book. This was the hymn book that God gave His people. So, the book of Psalms should be sung devotionally, should be preached evangelistically. And the primary purpose of Psalms is to focus on God, to be God-centered, that every psalm will point us to God and help us center our thoughts and our minds upon God. Now, let me show you just a couple of things here. We think about the superscriptions or the notations that we find in the book of Psalms. More than 3/4 of the Psalms, 116 of them to be exact, have a superscription added at the beginning, before the psalm begins, that provides a little editorial notation, so to speak, that identifies the author the historical background and how it should be sung. And all but 34 psalms have these superscriptions or these notations. Now, what you need to know is this. The notations were added after the time that the psalms were written. And they were written, they were added to help the worship leader. So the worship leader would know what to do, how to sing the psalm. I'll show you what I mean in just a minute. And these notations were not part of the original text. By that I mean they were not inspired of God, the notations. They were added later after the book of Psalms was written. The book of Psalms was inspired. But the notations was written later by men to help the music directors know what they were to do in using the psalm to lead in worship. But they're still reliable for what they were written, because they were written for instruction to the music director who would be leading. You understand what I'm saying, or did I confuse everybody? The book of Psalms, now hear this, the book of Psalms is inspired just like all the other books of the Bible. It is the inerrant word of God. The notations above the psalms were added later to instruct the musicians so that they would know how they were to use these psalms in leading worship. I don't want anybody to be mixed up about that, because we all know God's word is God's word. Amen? And let me show you how this works. Sometimes you'll find historical information about the author. For example, look at Psalm 3. And before verse 1, what does it say in your Bible? Okay. The Psalm of David when he fled from Absalom's son. So that gives us the author. It gives us the historical context. We know that David wrote it as he was inspired by the Lord, and that he wrote it during the time of Absalom's rebellion. So that's a little superscription or notation to help us. And then some of the titles were used to provide instruction. For example, turn over there to chapter 4 and read the superscription before verse 1. What does it say? Okay, so you see there's the instruction to the minister of music. This is to the chief musician, that's the Levite who's leading worship, with stringed instruments, so that they know this psalm is to be sung with stringed instruments, with a harp or a lyre, and it is a psalm of David. So that gives him instruction. He knows what to do with that. And then there are also important pauses in the book of Psalms. And from time to time, we see the little word Selah. You remember that? You come across that word various times in the Psalms. In fact, I think 71 times we find that in the Psalms. And all that means is this is a brief pause or an interlude that is put there for a purpose. It either calls for a change in the musical accompaniment, I have a hard time saying that word, or it means you pause for emphasis to reflect and think about what it just said. John Phillips, when he wrote his commentary on the psalm, says that Selah means, hey, what do you think of that? And I like that. It means to stop and to look at it and to reflect upon it, to meditate on it. So we see that over and over again. For example, look at chapter 3, verse 4. In the third chapter of the Psalms, verse 4. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. And then you see the word? Selah. Selah. So that's a pause. That's either for the music to change, or it's for us to reflect upon that statement that was made by the Lord. Now, did you know there are five books in the book of Psalms? actually five different books in this one book that we call the Book of Psalms. And these are the book divisions. This is often called the Psalter. And these books were originally collected by ancient compilers, the smaller books, and then were put together as one large book, the Book of Psalms. Now, a lot of conservative Bible scholars that we respect and appreciate believe that five books of the Psalms correspond with the first five books of the Bible. You know, we've studied Genesis through Deuteronomy, and we know that is the Pentateuch. That is the law of Moses. And so a lot of conservative scholars believe that the first book of Psalms can be traced back to the book of Genesis. And the second book of Psalms can be traced back to the book of Exodus, and so on and so forth. But let me give you these division breakdowns. Book 1 is chapters 1 through 41. Chapters 1 through 41. And more than likely these were gathered by David or Solomon in the early days. Book 2 is Psalm 42 through 72, about 300 years after Book 1. Book 1 and 2. Book 3 is made up of Psalm 73 through 89. And it's interesting to me that this third book begins with 11 consecutive psalms written by Asaph, who was the leader of the temple choir. He was a minister of music. And he wrote the first 11 in that third book. Book 4, chapters 90 through 106. 90 through 106. About 200-300 years after Book 3 that was written. And then finally Book 5, 107 to 150. And that was about 600 years after Book 1 was written. So you may have known that, but there are actually five books that make up the Book of Psalms written over this period of time. Each book can be traced back and equivalent to one of the books of the law, the Pentateuch. So it's an interesting read when you read it that way. And you understand that history behind it. We could spend a lot of time talking about the literary style of the Book of Psalms. I cannot even remember if I put that on the outline. I did not. I understand why I did not. Because when we get into the literary styles, it's good. How can I say this? It's kind of like reading through Deuteronomy, I guess, or maybe Leviticus. So we're not going to spend a lot of time on the literary style found in the Book of Psalms, other than I want to say to you this. The writers of Psalms used colorful language. They used a lot of word pictures. They used Hebrew poetry to write the Psalms. Hebrew poetry is different from our English poetry. Our poetry is rhyme and meter. Their poetry had very little rhyme in it, but it had parallelism in it, where they would say something and then say it again. Carolyn, you remember all this from CBC.
Well,
we
said that in
Sunday
school. She just
oh, okay.
It, she remembered that I said that. I appreciate
good,
that.
Good. That's great. So if you want to study that, that's a good thing to study, because you're going to be swimming in some deep water, aren't you? To look at that parallelism and all of the way that the Psalms are constructed. But what I want you to remember is mainly that the Psalms are written with these beautiful pictures, figures of speech that God uses as a device to help us remember these truths. And you say, well, is the Bible literally true? Well, I happen to believe it is. I believe it is literally true. And you know for me long enough to know that. But God also uses these pictures to impress upon our hearts and minds so that we can remember, so that this stays with us. For example, in the Psalms, you'll find the vine and the branches. You're going to find vivid pictures like a tree planted by rivers of water. Now, that just stays with you when you think about that tree. You know what I think about when I read that Psalm? That tree planted by the river of water? I think about a place out on the lake where I grew up as a kid, and all those trees were along the riverbank where we would swim. And God planted them there along the water, and they would always be so beautiful. And that is a word picture that God uses to stick in our mind. And so he uses that throughout the Psalm. Most importantly of all, I want you to see, and we'll wrap this up, that the book of Psalms is a life-changing book. Actually, I had hoped today to be able to do an exposition on Psalm 51, but we're running out of time, and I can't do that. But I want you to understand this is a life-changing book. In fact, Martin Luther studied two books that just really God used to turn his heart and bring about the Reformation. One, of course, was the book of Romans, where the Bible says the just shall live by faith. But the other, and this is not well known, was the book of Psalms. Martin Luther loved the book of Psalms. In fact, in latter years, he became so discouraged being persecuted for his belief that he suffered bouts of despair and even dark depression. He felt like the entire world was against him. It was a very dark time. And when he got like that, he had a co-worker named Philip. And he would go to his co-worker and he would say, "Philip, let's sing a chapter in the Psalms." And one of those chapters that he loved to sing was Psalm 46. And if you look at that, here's what he would sing. "A sure stronghold, our God is he, a timely shield and weapon, our help he'll be and set us free from every ill can happen." Now, if that sounds a little familiar to you, from that psalm came "A mighty fortress is our God." A mighty fortress is our God. That's perhaps the greatest hymn in the church. And it's drawn from Martin Luther as he studied the Psalms and he went through this horrendous time in his life. My prayer for all of us today is this: as we spend time in the book of Psalms, that God will fortify our hope in him and fill our heart with adoration, because he alone is worthy to be praised. God alone is worthy to be praised. So sometime this week, get by yourself, pick out a psalm, and sing it to the Lord. Make up the tune. Just sing it to the Lord. All of us can do it. If I can do it, I know you can do it. So just pick it out and sing it to the Lord and enjoy that. And you're going to be surprised. That'll fill your heart. Don't be surprised if your eyes do not well up with tears, because it will fill your heart with the glory of God as you adore him. Thank you for being here today to look at the book of Psalms. Jerry, if you'll come, please.